Good morning.
That sounds big.
Are we ready to worship?
Amen.
Awesome. Why don't we stand and worship our Lord?
So aimless, life filled with sin, I will let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. Back his side. Pray, oh, I saw the light. I saw the light. I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night.
Now I'm so happy the sorrow inside.
How marvelous,
To you and your friend still.
still today. Cause there ain't no doubt I love you. God bless who you are. An American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the man who died and gave that right to me. And I'm glad we stand up next to you and you tempt us still today. Cause there ain't no doubt I love this man. God bless the USA.
Woo. Thank you, Lord. Lord, we thank you that we do live in a country that still trusts in you and believes in you and was founded on your principles, Lord. And help us just to carry those through in our daily walk, Lord, that we would glorify you and raise up our nation as a godly nation. So we praise you, Father. We just pray for an anointing on your word now, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please remain standing for the reading. I turned it on, I'm pretty sure. Yep, I'm on. There we go. Please remain standing for the reading of God's word. And this is a weekend where tomorrow we will be celebrating the uniqueness of America. And in spite of the struggles, the faults, the failures, America still stands supreme in bringing freedom of worship into a nation. And we are the testimony of that, and we get to celebrate that, and that is what we will enjoy. God's word to us this morning is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, verses 14 through 30. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He was teaching in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. He began by saying to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they said. Jesus said to them, "Surely you will quote this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself.' And you will tell me, 'Do here in your hometown what we have heard that you did in Capernaum.' Truly I tell you," he continued, "no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time, when the sky was shut for 3.5 years and there was a severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian." All the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up and drove him out of the town and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him off the cliff. But he walked right through the crowd and went on his way. Now, there is a very minor textual variant in one family of manuscripts that adds these words, "like a boss." I'm just kidding about that part. But that is how you make an exit. Good stuff. Father God, may you honor the reading of your word today with the work of your Holy Spirit as we set our ears, our minds and our hearts on hearing from you this day. Lord, may you teach us. Lord, may the words in your word speak to each of us, and may your spirit customize what it is each of us needs to hear. Those of us who are gathered in these moments in this place, those who are watching online, those who will watch at a later date, Lord, you already know, and I pray for your spirit to take your word and to impact each of our lives. Lord, may we be assured of the truthfulness of who you are. May we be renewed in our understanding of your goodness and your power. Lord, may our hearts and our minds be captivated by what it truly means to believe and to live for you and to follow you. Lord, may all the promises that you've read and you've given us in this text, may they be true. May our sight be restored. May our freedom be granted. May the Lord's favor be upon us. As always, Lord God, I ask for my words not to get in the way of your word, but for you to work, to speak, to bring glory to yourself, Father God, as your son Jesus is lifted up. And it's in the name of Jesus, our Savior, our Lord, your son, oh Father God, that we do pray. Amen. You may be seated. Very special hello and welcome to those joining with us in our live stream today. We are so glad that you are part of the Oak Park family. Remember, you can participate in today's service in real time by texting in comments, questions, prayer praises, or prayer requests to 805-481-7092. Once again, we're glad you're part of the family today. If you're watching at a later date, that number still works. We'll get to you soon. And if you text in and we don't have your number in our system, we would love to get your name as well so we can contact you and see how we can best help you grow spiritually, because that's what we're all about. If you do have your sermon notes, a couple things on that. If you don't have one, just raise your hand and one will be delivered to you real soon. These sermon notes are jam-packed, and what we're going to be dealing with today is just really kind of scratching the surface on a very contemporary and a very current issue, but we'll get to that kind of in the second half. But I got to set things up first, because this is one of the most seminal moments in the ministry of Jesus. This is where Jesus really begins to kind of go public with his mission and his message that he is the Messiah. And he goes to do that at his hometown of Nazareth. He's been away for a number of months, not quite a year, but real close. He was the local boy who made good. Nazareth is a tiny village up in the hills in what was northern Israel. It was a backwater. It was podunk. It was the hills, all that kind of stuff. Very sparsely populated. The village of Nazareth may have had 300 or 400 people, maybe a few more, maybe a few less. So Jesus was the small town boy who left home and went out into the world and made a name for himself. Now, of course, he was the Son of God, and he was on a mission. He was mandated by his Father and all of that. But Jesus had been gone for a number of months, but word, as it always does, had gotten back. Because, you know, no one knows more about your business than your family or those you grew up with, right? Yeah, you can't keep a lot of secrets from them, no matter how far away you go. Now, in these months, Jesus had met people. He had gathered disciples. That means that there were a group of men who had been so enamored with what Jesus had told them and how he had spoken to them and what he was training that they actually oriented their lives around him. They were following him from village to village as he preached and as he taught and as he healed. But he actually gathered people to follow him. He had created an entourage. They were students. They were followers. Learning about God from him. He had already performed miraculous signs. He had already healed people. And some of those healings were off the charts. They were so different than most of the healings that had been done in his day. And yes, there were healings done by others in that time. But the way Jesus healed was different. For example, he commanded demonic spirits to leave. And we learn in the scriptures that, yes, there were other Jewish religious leaders who did do that power. They also were able to exorcise demons out of people. But the way Jesus did it was with authority, was instantaneous. He commanded demonic spirits out of people. He also healed leprosy. Leprosy was an absolutely horrific disease in the ancient world. It was considered incurable. Now it might go into a dormant stage, but for the most part, it was something you were stuck with the rest of your life, and there was exclusion and isolation, and there was social stigma, and all these things. Jesus actually healed leprosy. And there's only one person in the Old Testament, was the prophet Elisha. And even though Elisha was able to bring healing to a person with leprosy, the scriptures attribute the healing to God. And that was the perception of the people. Leprosy was so awful, it was so contagious, it was so difficult to deal with, that healing of leprosy could only come from God himself. And here Jesus was healing people with leprosy. As Jesus taught, the crowds became larger and larger. He was able to gain a following of people. This is the days, obviously, before computers, electricity, the internet. Jesus went viral without the help of stupid videos like on TikTok. He was not able to do a podcast that was able to capture the hearts and minds of people. He actually had to go to people and talk to people, and then those people told their friends, their neighbors, their relatives, their entire villages, we heard this amazement. You are not going to believe what he had to say. The way he teaches is unlike anything we've heard. And then he healed us. I've struggled with this for years. Jesus healed me. I saw a person with an arm who was deformed and disfigured and didn't work. And Jesus just touched him in the arm, stretched out, and was whole. They just told people. Jesus went viral. Large crowds came to his teaching. Jesus had done an excursion into the big city, the Jewish capital, Jerusalem, and he knows how to make an exit like we read in our text. He also knows how to make an entrance. He goes into the temple, and there, that's his father's house. He's the Son of God. The temple, one section was completely filled with people who were extorting the populace in the worship rituals. You see, the temple was where the sacrifices had to be made, and animals were the objects of that sacrifice. And there was different animals for different types of sacrifices. The blood of animals covered certain types of sins. And so the temple system, the Sadducees had set up a whole system of how to extort people in their religious worship, because only certain types of animals and certain qualities of those types would be accepted for worship. So they had to be spotless and unblemished. They couldn't be deformed. They couldn't be disfigured. They couldn't be too young. They couldn't be too old. All those kinds of things. And so they had quite the system of, we will provide for you the right animals for your sacrifice at a price. And actually, there was a lot of corruption, because oftentimes these families would raise the goat. Or the bull and the calf, and all these things had to be sacrificed, and they would bring it, and then the guardians of that system would say, oh, you know what, well, we see that this hoof isn't right. You're going to need one of ours. This one will not work. And so they would force the family to exchange their animal for one of their animals, and of course, the exchange rate was never equal. It was always, you have to pay extra. And then they would take those animals, they would place them in the back until the next day or another family came along, and they would say, oh, your animal's not going to work. Let me get one of yours. Then they would bring out that animal. That's a racket. That is injustice. That is just awful. That is evil. But that's what the system was. And that's what Jesus started overturning the tables and running people out. And says, you will not corrupt my house. This is to be a house of prayer for all people. So Jesus had cleansed the temple. That created quite a controversy. Even early on in his ministry, the rabbis, who were the pastors, the teachers of the people, of the things of God, even the rabbis knew that Jesus was a rabbi. And the word rabbi means a great one, a master, a teacher. One of the highest ranking Jewish authorities in the entire country, Nicodemus, came to Jesus and says, Rabbi, we know you are sent from God. No one can do the works you're doing unless God has sent him. So Nicodemus, a high ranking political figure and religious figure, tells Jesus, you're a rabbi, and we know you're from God. This is all before Jesus really goes public and declares his ministry and his mission that he is the Messiah. He waits to do that back home. So when Jesus comes home, you can imagine the stories from all those people in that small village where he had grown up. There would be a buzz in the synagogue that night because Jesus, he had grown up among us. He had gone and he had done all these wonderful, amazing things. People were listening to him. He was a special one from God, and now he's going to teach us. He was the honored guest at the weekly synagogue meeting, as was the custom. He got to select the text to be read, so he would tell the attendant, go pick the scroll of the prophet Isaiah. And the attendant would bring the scroll to him. And back in those days, remember, no chapters and verses. Those only came in about 500 years ago. And especially on the Hebrew scrolls, they would roll them out, and they'd have to roll. You know, for those from a broadcasting background, that's called dead air, while you wait. Couldn't get there quick. No tabs on the ancient scrolls to find the book easily. But Jesus rolls to the place, and then he reads the passage we know as Isaiah 61, verses 1 and 2. It was a section that was a prophecy about the Messiah. It was a very well-known text. Every good Jewish boy and girl, every religiously observant Jewish person would know this text because it spoke to the promise of the one God would send, the Anointed One. The Anointed One God would send to rescue, to redeem, and to restore his people. It was a pretty significant, pretty important text. It's Jesus' commentary on the passage. He reads the passage, and then as the guest speaker, he is the one privileged to expound on it, to explain it. And the commentary is what caused the problems. The opening line should have set off, you know, it should have set off warning signals right away. He hands back the scroll's placed, Jesus sits down, which that was the customary position for the teacher of the day. And he said, today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. If the people would have taken 2 or 3 seconds to really listen to what he said, they would have become outraged instantly. But instead, you know how it is. Local boy made good, comes home. Jesus has this great reputation. No matter what he says, there's going to be smiles and there's going to be glad handing and they're going to be like, oh, isn't he wonderful? You know, yeah. You know, when you're like a young kid and you're doing anything in like a youth Sunday, no matter what the kid says from the stage on youth Sunday, everybody's going to go, that was wonderful. That was so good. Yeah, the very first sermon I preached, that was the one where my dad fell asleep. That was lots of fun. That's a story for a different time. My dad was not a religious person. The only time he'd been in church, I think, in the last 50 years of his life. But he came to hear my very first sermon, my first official sermon as a Bible college student, and he did fall asleep. That sermon was absolutely terrible. I still have a copy of it somewhere. It wasn't that bad, but it was not good. But you know what? It was a Sunday evening service. The 30 people in that room, oh, that was just so wonderful. We're so proud of you. Because it was in my home church. I'd gone to Bible college. I'd come back. They were all enamored. That's the way it is with Jesus. You don't even hear what's being said. You only look at how it's being said and who's saying it. Oh, this is Joseph's son. This is so exciting. You know? Then after a few moments, it's like, wait a minute. What did he just say? Did I hear that correctly? He's reading a passage about the Messiah coming to do all these things, and did he just say, this is being fulfilled? You know, well, wait a minute, we're not captive. Well, we're oppressed by the Romans, but we're not captive. I don't need any freedom. I can see. I'm not blind. You know, I'm already a Jew. The Lord's favor is already upon me. What is he meaning with this? They were pretty enamored with his eloquence at first. But as he continues, and obviously Jesus said a lot more than is recorded here. He kept on talking more than what's recorded. And in this passage, yes, he is claiming to be the Messiah. And that was pretty blasphemous in the ears of the people. But even more than that, it is this passage, while accepted as a messianic prophecy, It was a messianic prophecy relegated in the pecking order of the messianic prophecies. He reveals that the Messiah's mission is not to crush the enemies of the Jewish people, but rather to conquer them through love and mercy. That was pretty paradigm shifting. The crowd's response quickly turned from impressed to incensed. They objected to both the message and the messenger. Now remember, these were the people he grew up with. They were the ones just moments before so excited, so proud. And within the course of a few moments, a few words, one passage of scripture, they were ready to kill him, to throw him off a cliff. For them to become enraged and potentially violent so quickly is a striking example and an important reminder of how Jesus' identity and words evoke powerful emotional reactions. We see that in our day a lot. But their harsh rejection of Jesus had some pretty significant consequences. The Gospel of Mark includes this one caveat, this one additional insight of this encounter that Jesus had in his hometown. Jesus said to them, "A prophet is not without honor except in his hometown, among his relatives, and in his own home." Here's what Mark adds. He could not do any miracles there except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. He was amazed at their lack of faith. Now, it's an important point. It's not that Jesus did not have the power to heal. It's that they did not have the faith to come and ask except for only a few. That was Jesus' hometown. This idea of the Messiah was so important because by the time of Jesus, the Jewish people had been under either in exile or oppression by other political empires for hundreds of years. The Jewish nation had ceased to be a sovereign nation over 500 years before. So all they knew, and all the generations before those people in the time of Jesus, all they knew was being oppressed by a foreign power, paying exorbitant taxes, having absolutely no political power or representation in those empires and in those systems. That was hundreds of years they lived with that. And so as God sent the prophets began to speak and to reveal the next phase of God's plan, which was to send one, an anointed one, the one who would come, the Messiah, the Redeemer. And the mythology of that Messiah, when read literally from some of those prophecies, is that the Messiah would be a political and a military ruler. There were a number of prophecies that spoke of the Redeemer coming and ruling with like an iron scepter and executing judgment upon God's upon the enemies of God's people. And that imagery from some of those texts, when fueled with the reality of day-to-day oppression, you can understand how the desire for vengeance would grow. And you understand how those certain texts about the Messiah would become almost the canon within the canon, the special verses that people would fixate on. Because when you are being oppressed, when you are being overly taxed, when you don't have such a thing as human rights, which did not exist back in that day, when life is difficult, and death is all around you, and executions were almost daily because of political insurgency and upheaval, all that kind of stuff, you can understand how some of those texts would say God is going to send someone who is going to take it to our enemies, who is going to restore us to a rightful place, who is going to put us back on top, and it will be God's people reigning and ruling over all of the infidels and the goyim, the Gentile, the non-Jews. You can understand how those texts would take hold and grow, and then the mythology would grow. And some of the Jewish literature outside the Bible really built it up. Oh my goodness. The Messiah was going to come with fire and power and light and just going to wipe out the enemies of God. Some pretty interesting reading. But there were those passages, but there was also messianic prophecies like the one in Isaiah. The mission of the Messiah was not just to bring a righteous rule, but also to bring good news to the poor, recovery of sight to the blind, freedom for the captives, to set free the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. You see, the passages that spoke of a literal king and military leader coming, those passages were interpreted very literally. And the passages like Isaiah, about all this good news to the poor and recovery of sight, release of the captives, those were interpreted metaphorically. The problem with the Jewish interpretive system is that the passages about the reigning and righteousness and the executing judgment, they're the ones that needed to be interpreted metaphorically. And the passages regarding the Messiah suffering, like Isaiah 53, Psalm 22, Isaiah 61, those were the ones that needed to be interpreted literally, because that was the true message of Jesus. And the metaphors, and this is the way it works out, because when Jesus sets the captives free, when he proclaims the year of the Lord's favor, that is truly exercising authority and reign and rule, because it's over a person's heart, which is the most difficult kingdom to be conquered for anyone. Speaking on these themes, the justice that is in this passage that Jesus reads, justice and injustice are a major theme in the Hebrew Scriptures, what we call the Old Testament. Justice and righteousness are inextricable. And in your notes, this is probably the most important section of all the notes. So I really hope you focus in on this. Justice and righteousness are inextricable, means they are completely woven together. They are inseparable. A righteous person is not merely moral personally. We always think of righteousness as personal righteousness, personal holiness, personal morality. You don't smoke, drink, or chew or go with girls who do, right? Then you're a righteous person. And yes, personal piety, personal holiness, living righteously, yes, that is a component, personal moral responsibility. But biblically, you cannot be a righteous person if merely focused on the self. A righteous person, a righteous man, a righteous woman in God's eyes, according to God's word, is one who executes justice for those who are oppressed, those who are poor, those who are captured by the darkness, those who are struggling in sin, those who are set upon by the powers of this world. A righteous person advocates and then acts for justice for those who are suffering injustice. This is such a huge issue today. There's a stark contrast, however, between biblical justice and social justice as it is being advocated and advanced today. It's something that's very, very in vogue right now. Now, there are some similar goals, and I got to preface this as well. This is obviously a very deep, very complex subject. We're only touching on a few of some minor points. This is kind of like a primer for this. If you want more research, more study, you want more resources to really delve into this, at the bottom of my notes is my email address. Email me. I will send you a bibliography. I'll send you some links and some things like that. So take what I'm about to say with the understanding that this is just merely scratching the surface of a very complex and very deep issue. But here's the main point. What is being advocated and advanced as social justice today is not the equivalent of biblical justice that we see in the Scriptures. The mission and the methodology of the Messiah, what Jesus came to do, he is our model. He is the one who sets the priorities for what biblical justice truly is. Social justice is about political power. Biblical justice is about personal transformation. And when personal transformation happens under the reign and the rule of God, then political power in the world, remember, the whole world is under the control of the evil one, 1 John 2:2. It is when personal transformation happens that then the systems, the structures, the power brokers of society are influenced, or more importantly and more appropriately, subverted. That is the mission of those who follow the Messiah. Just a few high points. Social justice locates evil in cultural systems. Biblical truth locates evil within the human heart. And it's only the Holy Spirit who can transform the human heart. With that being said, yes, there are unjust laws. Just because a law is a law does not mean it is right, righteous, moral, or just. There are unjust laws. There are unjust policies politically and elsewhere. There are unjust economic practices and so much more. The problem is not that those things exist. The problem is that those things exist because they were created out of corrupt, deceitful, sinful human hearts. And laws, policies, and regulations may change certain behaviors, but they will not and cannot change the predilections of the heart. That can only happen in an encounter with God in Jesus, in the power of God to come into a person's life and transform them completely, to move them from dead in sin to alive in Christ, to replace the old with the new, to regenerate them inside, to transform their thinking. That's when real change comes to the person, to the family, to the community, to the society, to the nation, to the world. And that's what we've seen as Jesus come into the world. Those under the reign and the rule of Jesus as the Messiah have increased exponentially. And yes, the world is still messed up in a lot of ways, but it is a whole heck of a lot messed up since Jesus arrived. Social justice is to equalize all, rather than to elevate and empower, equip and encourage those who are oppressed, those who are downtrodden, those who have been taken advantage of. It's more about bringing down than lifting up. And that's a big discussion. But the goal is never absolute equality for all. The goal is to bring mercy, compassion, and help. Those whom God has blessed with resources, use those resources for good and for expanding the kingdom and for helping people. Jesus said, you know, what good does it for a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? Most of us here in this room, most of us listening and watching today or at whatever time, we are among the richest, wealthiest, most abundantly resourced people this world has ever seen. No, we are not Russian oligarchs. No, we are not Saudi oil multi-billionaires. But what we have and what we can do with what we have can make more of a difference in this world for eternity than we will ever realize if we just do it. For social justice, the idea of freedom comes with power, political power and power of self-identity, these kind of things. But biblically, the idea of freedom is about forgiveness. Forgiveness first from God. You know, the word translated freedom in this text, throughout the book of Luke, almost every other time that very same word is translated, it is translated with the word forgiveness, because forgiveness means release of obligation from debt. And that's why people were imprisoned in the ancient world. They had a debt. They did not pay. They could not pay, so they were put in prison until they could. It's a weird system. You don't understand it, but that was what they did back then. The idea was, okay, so-and-so takes out a loan. He doesn't pay the loan. The person he's in debt to turns him over to the authorities. They arrest him. They put him in jail. And then that will motivate those who love him and need him and miss him to go work, swindle, coerce, beg, whatever it is, to get that amount to pay off the debt. That was what forgiveness was the paying off of the debt in a monetary sense, but also in a spiritual sense. When we sin, we incur a debt to God. And that's what Jesus is really proclaiming, is that the debt we could never repay has been paid, not by us, but by himself. For social justice, this idea of sight to the blind, sight has been replaced with the word woke, which comes from being awake or awakened to the injustice of the world, the inequalities, and all those kinds of things. And that is a good perspective. Yes, we need to be aware of those things. But what that has turned into, once again, takes the emphasis away from the personal transformation, where Paul prays for the eyes of the heart to be enlightened, where we read in the book of 1 John, one of Jesus' closest followers, the apostle of love, and when he speaks about that God is light, in him there is no darkness at all. And if we are to live in the light, if we are to live with a full sight and a full view and a full vision, if we are to be truly awake, we are awake to the light, our eyes are open to the light, and when we are open to the light, we will then love as God is love and as God has loved us in Jesus. That's what it truly means. Recovery of sight to the blind. Yes, Jesus did heal physical blindness, but spiritual blindness, spiritual darkness encompasses more lives. For social justice, one of the most difficult things is that in social justice, as it's currently portrayed, there is no freedom from oppression because the struggle never ends. There is no release. There is no freedom. There's no ultimate victory. It's always overcome this and go to the next level of oppression. But biblical freedom is oppression from sin through adoption to sonship. Jesus said, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. But if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. Social justice is essentially atheistic, by the way. But Jesus came to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Fortunately, year is more of a symbol. The year, the coming of something new, the year of the Lord's favor, excuse me, is a new relationship where the Lord's favor will be upon those who love him. It's a reference to salvation, and it's a state of blessing that brings unity among people. Social justice seeks to continually divide and isolate and pit different people against one another. But the message of Jesus, the kingdom of God, the power of the gospel is to unite in spite of the differences, in spite of the diversity. Whether it be economic diversity or racial diversity, yes, even political diversity, all of those things, we are united in Jesus. It's really the only thing that truly unites. We will never all be equal economically. We will never agree politically. Dodgers fans and Giants fans just are not going to get along. Which is why it's so much better to root for a team like the Mariners. Because they're never going to win. It never becomes a big issue. You just enjoy it every once in a while when they win. But there's going to be continual divisions among people. But it's the gospel that unites. In the gospel, it does not matter what color our skin is, because the color of Jesus' blood is what has united us and made us brothers and sisters. It is not the economic disparities or differences that will divide us, because in Jesus, those who have been blessed and resourced economically, when they are following Jesus, will use those blessings of God to bless others. Great mercy, compassion comes from that. And so much more. It's the social justice is all about continually dividing in micro divisions more and more. That's where the power from that comes. But the gospel is about unity and bringing together and loving one another in spite of differences. That's the power of following Jesus. And Jesus as the Messiah, his mission is our mandate. The Great Commission, Jesus' marching orders was for people to believe in him, and those who were to believe in him were to become disciples, not just believers, not just church attenders, but disciples, students, learners of how to live differently than the ways of the world by following Jesus. And we are to become disciples who help other people become disciples. That's the mission, that's the mandate, that's the Christian life. Yes, developing a deeper prayer life is good. Memorizing Scripture, studying Scripture, familiarizing yourself with Scripture, diving into Scripture. Yes, that is all good. But it's all to be poured out into the lives of others. Serving in the church is good and necessary. And yes, we need more, by the way. So volunteer, serve, get involved. But the service is the purpose of helping others be and become disciples of Jesus. That's the mandate. We are to live our lives like the example of Jesus, who is our Lord and our teacher. The Apostle John, writing late in his life, says, "If anyone obeys his word, love for God is truly made complete in him. This is how we know we are in him. This is how we know Jesus is alive in us. This is how we know we belong to Jesus and follow Jesus. This is how we know whoever claims to live in him must live as Jesus did." That does not mean moving to the Middle East and Palestine and wearing long garb and wearing open-toed sandals. That is not what this means. Thank God. What it means is living a life modeling and emulating Jesus in how he loved others and cared for others and spoke to others, how he accepted others, and how he treated others. It's about following Jesus. In fact, our true spiritual growth is measured in how well we embody his teachings. Love one another as I have loved you. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Whenever someone strikes you on one cheek, turn to him the other. It is more blessed to give than to receive. All of these things, when those become the hallmarks of how we live our day-to-day lives, that's spiritual growth. In the Gospel of Luke, Jesus said, "The student is not above the teacher, but everyone who is fully trained will be like their teacher." If Jesus is our teacher, we will be like him. Jesus even promises that his disciples will do greater works. Greater works than him. "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do. And greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son." What that means is, in a nutshell, because Jesus died for our sins and rose from the dead and reascended into heaven and has taken his rightful place at the right hand of God, he then sent the Holy Spirit into the lives of everyone who believes in Jesus. Therefore, an army has been amassed around the globe throughout the centuries. And instead of the Messiah being located in one small section, in one small region of the world, now the presence of God, the power of God, the purpose of God can be lived out and demonstrated and enacted in every culture, in every society, in every realm of society, to every strata of society. Greater works, it's exponential. What God now does in his kingdom, it's exponential in scope, and we are a part of it. Grover Beach, Arroyo Grande, Pismo Beach, Napomo, San Luis, Santa Maria, and wherever else we may reside. We are not just outposts, not just small areas, What we do has eternal impact and significance because the Spirit of God is upon us. The Spirit of God is upon us as followers of Jesus to proclaim good news to the poor, to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, to proclaim recovery of sight for the blind, to set free the oppressed, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Paraphrasing Nike, let's do it. I'd like to have Mike and the team come back up as we prepare for a time of communion. Communion is where we take the work of God's Spirit in our lives through His Word and we bring it back to Jesus. We bring it back to the sacrifice of Jesus for our sin that set us free, paid our debt. We bring it back to Jesus for the resurrection that sets us free from the greatest oppressor of all, which is death. And in the act of communion, we take bread, we take juice. It represents the body of Jesus that took our sin, the blood of Jesus that paid for our sin, and the body and the blood of Jesus that was reunited in the resurrection to conquer death and to give us eternal life. Communion is open to all who are believers in Jesus. We ask simply that you examine yourself. You do a mental self-assessment of where you are in faith, of what you need to repent from, of how to renew your faith, how to simply just, you know, reflect on that. We're going to sing a song of praise, and then after the song, we will come forward. You may pick up one of the very sanitary elements, a set of elements for communion, and return to your seat. Please remain standing, and then we will share in the act of communion together as a community, hence the word. Would you please stand as we sing and as we prepare our hearts?
You're my healer. I believe.
We don't. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In remembrance of Jesus taking our sin in his body on the cross, we partake. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me," in remembrance of a new relationship with God as Father through faith in God the Son, we partake. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Over the last few months, we've been doing an affirmation of our shared faith in what is represented in communion. So today we have a choice, we have a test. We do not have the words of our affirmation on screen. So, for those of you who've been coming to Oak Park for a few weeks, how confident are you that you remember it? I'm not that confident. I remember it, and I do it every single week. But I'm going to try, okay? So we don't have the words on the screen. We'll see if we can go from memory. In the act of communion together, we affirm our faith in the crucifixion of Jesus for the forgiveness of our sins. Together, we affirm our faith in the resurrection of Jesus for the gift of eternal life. And together, we declare our shared abiding hope of eternity with our Lord, the Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
All right. You may be seated because we've got a couple of baptisms.
Well, praise the Lord.
Happy 4th of July weekend, everybody. Little quirk, don't have your fireworks. That's when we're still out the parking lot. Good glorious day, huh?
Amen. Yep. Just one of the best things ever. Always love it. In fact, love it so much, we got another baptism we're celebrating. Bill, come on up. All right. Bill was baptized into Christ last Sunday during the service, so we've got your evidence of that, other than the video we have as well. This is your certificate of baptism, just to have and to hold and to enjoy. Lord, we want to just welcome you to life in Christ, but also officially into membership at the Oak Park family. You're already here, you're already family. This just seals the deal and makes it all official.
Thank you, so, Mike.
You betcha, man. Hold on, so I got to pray for you. Would you please join me in prayer? Father God, I thank you so much for Bill's life and for his faith. Lord, the way you have worked within him, especially in the last 2 to 3 years, Lord, we're just so grateful for his witness, his life transformation, the love from you that has really grown into his heart and his mind. Lord, the life that he now has by following your son Jesus, Lord, we are just overjoyed with the joy that he has from all he has found in following you. Lord, I pray for your blessing upon him as he continues to grow and engage in your word and just to study and to learn, but as mostly as he just learns to continue to live in your light and shine forth that light to others in just his love, his service, and his joy. Lord, we pray for these blessings in the name of Jesus upon Bill. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, man.
Thank you.
You bet. Oh, thank you. Bill is truly a servant. He just picked up my communion set, and he'll go throw it away for me. Very nice. Excellent. All right, we just have a few announcements I do want to hit. If you are If you are newer to Oak Park and you've never filled out a connection card, we would really like the opportunity to meet you, get to know you officially with having names and contact. We do send out a weekly email that has a lot of information about the church, but mostly we just want to know how to best help you grow spiritually. So we'd love to have the chance to meet you. If you've never filled out a card, please do so. First time filling out a card, take it to the Welcome Center. We got some information about the church. We've got a gift as well, but you also have the opportunity to make a real difference in the lives of those who are hurting in our community. You will have a very tangible way to, you know, bring good news to the poor. Because you're here today, Oak Park will make a donation in your name and in your honor to one of three local homeless agencies. It'll be the one of your choice: People's Kitchen, Five Cities Christian Women, or Five Cities Homeless Coalition. That's just one of the ways we try to live out this mission and this mandate from Jesus. Just one of the things that we do. There's also prayer request or praise forms in the back of the row in front of you. You can fill those out and turn those in, along with your tithes and offerings in the offering boxes that are on the back wall at the exits. Obviously, tomorrow is the 4th of July. So we are doing our annual 4th of July barbecue and fireworks show. The barbecue starts going at 6. We'll have hamburgers and hot dogs, but if you want to bring tri-tip, go ahead and bring tri-tip. Just notice there will be a temple tax on tri-tip, and I will be the priest observing the temple tax for that. But whatever else you want to bring to sacrifice, that's good. We're not gonna turn you away on that. Just kidding with that kind of stuff. We'll have hamburgers and hot dogs. Bring a side to share. Bring a dessert, and then we'll be pooling together fireworks for our little show. But we're also set up so that not only do we have a nice little show ourselves, but we also have a perfect vantage point for watching the Oceano War Zone. It is a great spot. So that will be tomorrow. Everybody's welcome and invited for that. I think that's the biggest news for now. I will be available. Oh, yeah, we'll have a bounce house for the kids. Actually, a bouncy slide for the kids. What was that? Oh, and the bouncy slide will be there from 5 until 8, so kids can come and have a good time. Is there an age limit? Oh, is there a weight limit? It's probably the more important issue. All right. Let's see. I'll be available at the front for prayer for anyone who wants us some prayer or some counsel. And John, do you want to join me today on that? You ready? Ready to jump into the fray? All right. So John will be up here with me. He's also going to be willing to pray with people. If you choose to go to John rather than me for prayer, my feelings will not be hurt. It will go on your permanent record, but my feelings will not be hurt. I'm just kidding on that. People, we need prayer, and we need to pray. So let's do more of that as well. All right, I think that's it. Let's stand for our song of praise and our closing prayer as well. Father God, thank you for our day together. Lord, may we be your people in this world. May your love for us transform us so much that we are agents of your love for those who are hurting, those who are oppressed, those who are suffering injustice, those who are downtrodden. Lord, may we be light in a very dark world. May we bring hope and help and healing to all who need. Lord, may we be you in the lives of those who need to meet you. These things we pray in your name as your disciples, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen. It's God and country in that order.
This land is your land, this land is my land. California, to the Ohio, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream water. This land is made for you and me. God bless America, land that I love. Guide her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountain to
Have a wonderful 4th.